Hello and a very warm welcome. You're watching an India Today special broadcast brought to you in association with Industry Chamber FICCI. We're building up to the big budget of 2021, which the finance minister describes as a once in a hundred year exercise. It's once in a hundred year because it comes in the middle of a raging pandemic, which has impacted growth numbers. It's also impacted the government's ability to spend and raise resources. What should be the finance minister's priorities? How can we get the economy back on track soonest? To talk about this, I'm joined on this special broadcast by the current president of the Federation of Indian Chambers of Commerce and Industry, Mr. Uday Shankar. With us also on this broadcast is Dr. Sangeeta Reddy, the Joint Managing Director of Apollo Hospitals. We have Rashesh Shah, he's the chairperson of Edelweiss Group and one of the sharpest minds in the financial sector in this country. Last but not least, Naina Lal Kidwai, former president of FICCI and chairperson of Advent India Advisory Board. I want to go across to the FICCI president first. Mr. Uday Shankar, if you can lay out for those watching at this time what you believe should be the finance minister's most pressing priorities. There's so many multiple pulls and pressures. Where do you think she should be focusing her time, energy and resources on?
Thank you, Rahul. Just to come to your point question straight away, I think there are three macroeconomic themes that have self-selected themselves given the context that we talked about. First and foremost, to create demand. The second one is to encourage infrastructure spend, again, which should create and stimulate demand. And the third one, which is very important given the given the circumstances we find ourselves in, is to increase the social sector outlay. And I think there is broad consensus across the country that these three are the most important one, and I'm sure that the finance minister will be focusing on these three too. I think the government has rolled out a very ambitious agenda for strengthening the manufacturing ecosystem. That would certainly come under a lot of attention of the finance minister. One area that I personally think needs special attention is the strengthening of the MSME sector and making sure that its revival and energization is accelerated. And that will also help the generation of demand, and also a lot of employment capability would be revived. I think these are very broadly the areas that that would be top of the mind of the finance minister in my view.
Rashesh Shah, we're also seeing at this time the stock markets touch 50. There's been a sharp correction over just the past 5 days, but that apart, there is a, you know, there is what seems from the outside an irrational exuberance that we've seen over the past several weeks. What is it that you believe needs to be done to try and build the exuberance that we're seeing in the markets and bring it more in line with the mood on the real street so that there is actually no mismatch which is being seen at this moment? How do you think the finance minister should try and approach that?
Absolutely, Rahul. As you said, you know, the markets are always ahead of the economy because the market is ultimately a discounting mechanism. So the market is discounting a rebound, a turnaround in the economy, what we have all seen last 4 months. And I must say the last 4 months have been phenomenal. It has taken everybody by surprise, but the resilience of India's economy and the growth has been marvelous. And whether it's housing, whether it's automobile, steel, cement, consumer durables, we are seeing a strong rebound in activity, and that itself is giving a lot of confidence to the markets. Along with that, you know, global liquidity is ample. Indian liquidity has improved a lot because, as you know, last 2 years, Indian economy suffered really from a liquidity crunch, which started in 2018. So given all these factors, I think there is an, you may call it exuberance, or I would call it a sense of optimism. And the optimism is not just for the budget or for the next few months. I think it is for the next few years that India's growth curve should catch back, should come back to the normal that used to be there, which is between about 6 to 8% real growth. In fact, for the coming year, I think it's going to be one of the easier ones for the finance minister, because the problems are of FY21, which is fortunately getting over soon. But for FY22, even IMF has projected 11.5% GDP growth for India, which is the highest in the world. and if 11.5 is the real growth,
but that's also where the base effect comes into place. Yeah, 11.5% growth projected on decline in the economy of 8% for this year. Therefore, it also says that for us to be able to hit the pre-COVID growth levels, we'll have to wait till 2025. So the pandemic has at least set us back for 5 years at the very least, according to the same IMF report that you're quoting, Ashish.
Absolutely. But you know, the good thing about all of us is, good thing about economy is, we have eyes in the front of our on our face, so we are always looking forward. So I think the destruction due to COVID has happened. I think it's happened, it is there, it is real. But now the markets, the investors, the optimism comes from looking forward. And I think for FY22, the government will have resources to spend. I think the key thing is how adventurous and ambitious they are in spending money, in loosening the fiscal purse string as you speak, because I think that is required. Because as you correctly said, currently there's a hypothesis of optimism, but to make it real, where the government will have to spend and give momentum to the economy, I think given the optimism that is there, given the liquidity that is there, government spending in this year and government really pushing the economic growth engine for this year is going to be very crucial.
We're already seeing Naina Lal Kidwai, the fiscal deficit expected to slip to 6-6.5 at the very least. That's the expectation by a group of economists. There's a lot of pressure from FICCI, from other industry chambers for the government to spend more. How much more spending capacity do you believe the government has? To what percentage would you like to see spending go up? And more importantly, where would you like to see the spending being concentrated? Because as you look around in the national firmament, you need to spend on military modernization more than ever, because there is military aggression by China along the line of actual control. We're still in the middle of a pandemic. We need to scale up the vaccination process. We need to make healthcare facilities more robust, take them into rural India, and we need to work on employment. So where do you think the government's spending power should be concentrated? Naina Lal Kidwai.
So you've asked the question really well, because it's clear that there's a very difficult juggling act for a government to look at all the spends that you have defined, each equally important, and on the other hand, a fisc which is already out of control in that it is much higher than what the government had set out for itself. But I'm of the school now that this is not the time to try and rein in the fisc. It is where it is, you know, the 6.5% as a given. I would rather see the government spend this year, but with a view to ensuring that we do not suffer on credit ratings, set out a new FRBM, a new fiscal regulatory mechanism, which says that, you know, COVID is what has caused the collapse. It is the pandemic that we have to recognize, but for the next 2 to 3 years, here's what we are going to do. And if that fiscal responsibility is recognized and a medium-term target set, I believe we will get some leeway without affecting the actual spends this year. In terms of the spends, you know, each one of these is important. I would like to see everything that continues to push and kickstart the economy, because there are still sectors that will continue to suffer. The MSME one, as was mentioned by Uday, is one that requires focus and support even today. In doing this, we need to get our banks back on track. We need the credit ratios to improve. 50% of GDP as a credit ratio is far lower than what most developed countries have, which is 100%. We need to open the purse strings through our banks. And in order to do that, we need to capitalize our banks, ensure that they can continue to support this growth. And again, for the medium term, a second area is we will not see the kind of growth we want or the kind of spending we want if our banks remain weak. So beyond the capitalization of banks, we have to tackle the bad loans, the NPAs, which are still very much in the system. And FICCI has...
So how concerned are you about the possibility that we're building, we're heading towards a massive bad debt crisis? The RBI report talks about how when the stimuli package is withdrawn, we could suddenly be faced in some time, if that happens sometime in the next fiscal, with the prospect of bad loans spiraling, companies going bust. How serious a problem do you think that is? How big a problem do you think that is? And what do you think Nirmala Sitharaman should be doing to try and address that problem? Do you buy into the idea of India needing a bad bank? And if we do, how should we structure it for it to make more sense?
So I think it is a problem that won't go away in a hurry, and RBI will also ensure that it is not sudden in the way it comes in. But tackling those loans is clearly something which we have to be doing, and there has been support through the system, the IBCs, the NCLTs, or banks themselves being permitted the moratorium. But the speed at which the settlement of these loans is happening is not adequate, and that needs attention. And I think structurally, therefore, what Fiki has suggested is going with the idea of a national asset company, a NAMCO or a bad bank, because I do believe that in doing that, we have a special structure which enables speedier settlement. It's very hard, particularly for the public sector banks, to take these decisions easily and assume write-offs. We know that they have tried, but it's not working at the speed it should. So I think putting in a structure such as that is helpful, making sure that our IBCs and NCLTs work, because there have been issues around COVID. The frequency of meetings are clearly an issue. We need to see that they are proper staffed. And if this can move quickly, there are many companies, many loans out there which will actually revive faster rather than be stuck as of now. So I think focus therein is very, very critical, and the laws and processes therein has to be given very high focus as we go forward. Bringing NBFCs into the banking net is also another way, because we will allow for larger banks to come into the system, which will help us in the not only in the near term but in the medium term as well.
Dr. Sangeeta Reddy, if we focus for a moment on the healthcare sector in which you specialize, A, how do you think the vaccination program is going so far? How long will it be for the vaccination program to reach a level of scale where the benefits of vaccination lead to the economy picking up faster than it would have in the absence of vaccination? And if healthcare spends are to be increased for in this union budget, how would you like that money to be spent for there to be maximum bang for every buck?
So Rahul, again, you stated the appropriate position, and that is the rate at which we are able to roll out the vaccination is directly proportionate to the recovery of the economy. And therefore, it is significantly important for us as a country together to ensure that at least 50 to 60% of our population gets vaccinated. And if you look at budget outlays, because we are talking just before the budget, you see last year's allocation at about 67,800 crores. If you calculate that for 50% of our population to get a vaccine at just 400 rupees, 200 is the vaccine, then you look at, you know, the manpower cost, the syringe, the digital validation. At about 400, you need a minimum of 27,000 crores to get 50% of our population vaccinated. So this itself will, you know, create a 40% jump in budgetary allocation. But looking at the overall, you know, how much of this will be handled out of pocket, all these are things which are evolving and emerging. Right now, I would say that having crossed more than 10 lakh people vaccinated, this is moving at a steady pace. The best part of it is that the reaction rate has been very, very low, and therefore our vaccines are safe, they are efficacious, and I think we're onto a very good path to recovery because of the science and the good government rollout. Besides this, of course, we must continue our path of growth. More infrastructure, more facilities, especially in rural areas. We must continue to enhance what we're doing in healthcare, which is more focus on primary healthcare and enabling the social determinants of health to actually minimize the disease burden. But finally, also, I think this is a great opportunity for India, as we have repositioned in the global market, to really reposition our healthcare capability. Before, India was thought of, a developing country where many people were denied care. In combination with Ayushman Bharat, the priming up of the primary healthcare centers, what we have been able to do in terms of vaccination, what the advanced healthcare systems, both in private and government, are doing. So we can reposition as a country which is delivering not just vaccines, but also the entire pharmaceutical sector. And now in the era of digital health, I truly visualize that India can reposition to say that a young India can use telehealth to take care of a graying world. So take care of our country or every single citizen, and then help to use healthcare as a growth activator. And in fact, many people have said that healthcare can do for India in this decade what IT did in the last decade. And of course, the final thing is we must continue to focus on research, for example,
where our vaccine diplomacy is winning brownie points for the people of India and the government of India the world over, and it is creating that goodwill around the India story. Uday Shankar, in her last budget, the finance minister spoke about the need to revive animal spirits, which in the midst of a pandemic, when the entrepreneur's own survival is at stake, the one animal spirit that gets activated most easily is the spirit to survive. When survival instinct is in overdrive, how does the government, you know, gravitate the entrepreneur and company management towards increasing their investments? Because, you know, increasing private investment is still a huge challenge for the government. And what are your solutions to try and ensure that the government is able to achieve this?
So now, look, there are a couple of factors that automatically trigger in as the economic revival gets stronger and stronger. I think we've seen that the capacity utilization is somewhere in the range of 60-65%. Once it crosses 75%, you will see investment coming in, because leaders and business managers will start planning for the future. There are also other signals. You know, if the government sends out the signals through economic reforms, through other stimulus measures, and by sheer confidence building statements, I think that's going to have a huge effect. Also, if the government spending, and you know, you talked about the revival setback that we have had, and how even an 11% growth rate for the next fiscal may not be able to get us out quickly. But it also speaks to one point, that even as we are still very much in the middle of the pandemic, just about 1 million people have been given the vaccine, there's a lot of fear and uncertainty, a lot of hesitation in people's minds, and restrictions on their movement.
Uday, how concerned are you that the scenes we saw in the national capital, the protest that's been raging for the last 2 months, will at some level, because ultimately the government is made up of political animals and political survival is important, while reform is important from the perspective of the economy and from corporate India's perspective, political survival is one of the key things that the government needs to worry about, and popularity. Are you concerned that this backlash will slow the speed of economic reform going forward, or at least ensure the government doesn't do something big, bold and dramatic like the industry would like them to?
So I hope that doesn't happen, Rahul, but yes, I am concerned about that. Personally, I am very, very concerned about that, because as you said, governments consist of political animals, and the kind of backlash that we've seen on this whole farm laws is not a good sign. And I think there is a larger issue here that we all need to be mindful of. There are, you know, it's tragic almost that there are no issues on which there is a political consensus, and almost nothing is beyond political diatribe, so to speak. Because we all know, look at this whole scope of the farm world. We all know, everybody has been saying that the farm sector needs to be reformed to unlock flow of capital, to bring in new technology, to raise incomes of the farmers. Everyone talks about it. And how are you going to be able to do that if you do not bring in reforms? And the moment somebody talks about doing a reform, usually we put the blames at the doorsteps of the government. That government, you know, when politicians are in the opposition, they talk about a lot of progressive things, but when they come to power, they forget about all that. In this case, it's just the reverse. And the backlash that's happened is clearly not a good sign. With the farm reforms, but by and large, the message for reforms is not good. And I also think that the other stakeholders in the society, including my own community, the corporate sector and the entrepreneurs and businessmen, for them to be not able to raise their voice in favor of this and stand up for the right things and raise their voice against what's not right in the larger interest of India and its people is not a good sign.
Rashesha, how are foreign portfolio investors, foreign institutional investors looking at the India story at this moment? Over the last few days, we've seen profit booking by FPIs, which is understandable given that the market had hit historic levels. But how do you see this in a 6 to 12 month horizon? What would foreign investors like to see from the government, from the finance minister, to ensure that, you know, a large part of their armory, or some part, or a great part of their armory, or a greater part of their armory is spent on the India story, is invested in the India story?
So actually, I think, as you correctly said, I think India needs foreign capital, because foreign capital and a lot of this capital is equity money or long-term patient capital, which we need for our economy. So I think keeping their needs in mind is very important. Fortunately, this is a good time, because I think A, global interest rates are low, they are looking for yield. India will be one of the higher growth countries even amongst all of them, because as you correctly said, the economy did go back last year and there is going to be a rebound. But even as compared to rebound in other countries, India's rebound is going to be much stronger. So I think we have the growth momentum in our favor. We have the global liquidity scenario in our favor. I think the US dollar is weakening and a lot of the money is looking for emerging markets, and even amongst emerging markets, India is very, very high up the list. So last few months, I have seen that portfolio investors are taking a very positive long-term view on India. I think somewhere around 2018-19,
So what are the policy triggers? I want to draw you out, Rashesh, by on what are the policy triggers foreign investors would be looking out for, the cues that they'd be watching out for in this budget, which would determine whether they want to increase their spends on India or reduce.
So I think the three or four things foreign investors are always looking for from India. You know, one is, I think, the privatization approach, because government has already promised through, you know, officials have spoken about privatization. Yesterday, the cabinet also passed a new privatization framework. So I think privatization is going to be a big one, but it's not only for this year. I think if the government can chart out a 3-4 year privatization kind of approach, because government has a capital allocation problem. A lot of government capital is stuck in banks and other places. They can take it out and spend it, as you know, on healthcare or infrastructure in other places.
Dr. Sangeeta Reddy, what are your thoughts on trying to reduce this kitsch that Rashesha speaks about? How to improve the ease of doing business, making India an easier place to operate in, not just for foreign investors, but also for domestic companies?
So I'll be very happy to talk about the importance of the ease of doing business, the cost of running a business, and the importance of being competitive as we have aspirations towards exports and many other areas. But I want to quickly add one point to Rashesh Bhai's very, you know, significant points, which was last year there was an introduction of a special incentive to sovereign funds to invest in infrastructure. And this waived capital gains, interest, etc. I think expanding that to all sources of capital coming into infrastructure and really incentivizing the infrastructure, creating patient capital so that the national infrastructure pipeline or the 10 lakh crores that we're trying to do commences, and we're able to begin and really accelerate that, because along with infrastructure spending, about 200 other sectors get benefited, and it's also a great employment generator for low-skilled or non-skilled employees. So I think it's critical for us to find ways to do that. Now, quickly shifting here to the ease of doing business, which is truly very important, and I must state that, you know, FICCI's been doing a lot of work on that. The government is focusing on it. It's a series of things. It's a series of, first, simplification of process, simplification of rules, regulation, and inspections, because so many times new laws have been added without the old laws being repealed. So it's just an add-on. And FICCI did about 2 years ago a study which said that there are over 6,000 different compliances required for a large scale or medium scale business. But I must say that the government, the Ministry of Commerce, they've all put together a special task force. We are part of that task force, and we foresee a significant simplification of laws, a large degree of digitalization, so that a company enters data once, and the back end, if 15 different governments need to see that data, it will be sorted out through a single window portal. Things like these are in the offing. I hope that the budget calls them out, funds them adequately, and ensures that they are accelerated.
So we've been able to touch upon different aspects of how to improve healthcare, how to take care of the bad loan problem, how to revive animal spirits, and also attract foreign investors in this special conversation, which is brought to you in partnership with FICCI. I want to thank Uday Shankar, Naina Lal Kidwai, Rashesh Shah, and Dr. Sangeeta Reddy for joining me for this special broadcast. And we look forward to now seeing what Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman makes of all these suggestions and everything else that she's had sent her way, and what she ultimately comes up with in what she calls a once-in-a-hundred-year budget. Thank you very much for joining us. We'll have more for you on the other side. Stay with us.